invitation and the introduction. Thank you. As we all, we've been listening to the problem of diabetes mellitus. Yes, it's a major global epidemic. Perhaps it's worse than the COVID-19. And we've been listening that early diagnosis is the best thing for treatment. So missing early diagnosis can lead to severe complications. And this paper, 2020, it's a very recent paper. But remember, for every lesion, we say that early diagnosis is the key. And for every lesion on earth, we say missing early diagnosis can lead to severe complications. And for every lesion, we say that teamwork is very important. And remember, when we use the general terms, these general terms, that means that there is something missing in the treatment. What about neglected or complicated cases of Charcot arthropathy? What's your protocol of treatment? Do you have one? I know that everybody has to keep amputation as a part of the treatment of these neglected cases or infected cases. Unfortunately, some people talk about amputation as a life-saving operation in cases of infection, Charcot arthropathy, severe deformities, dislocations, uncontrolled diabetes. And I've been listening to the commitment of the patients. Most of our patients are not committed to, because if the patient has uncontrolled diabetes for 15, 20, 30 years, how do you think that after the operation, he's going to have controlled diabetes after all these years? I don't think so. Does major amputation hasten death in patients with diabetes in comparison with limb salvage? Do you think so? The risk factors for major amputations are well known now, that you have bony invasions, hindfoot locations, elevated fasting blood sugar levels, bedridden patients, poor ambulation, and higher risk of amputation if you have hindfoot and ankle problem and osteomyelitis. There's almost an agreement about these problems. So I'm going to give you some examples. You have 60 years old female, overweight, on a wheelchair for about 1 year because of the deformity of the foot, uncontrolled diabetes, and the infected foot ulcer. I see she's really fat on a wheelchair patient. 65 years old female with infected ulcer, chronic osteomyelitis, and she had the bone scan because the plan was to do an amputation. So they want to know the limits for amputation. So they made this bone scan to see the limits for below-knee amputation. 75 years old female again, and she's too old with severe osteoporosis, uncontrolled diabetes for about 20 years, infection, legs, joints, Charcot foot with chronic osteomyelitis, which had been debrided many times before. You see chronic osteomyelitis and this ulcer, which had been treated many times by debridement, antibiotics, and again, the vascular surgeon and the orthopedic surgeon, they decided this is for amputation. I don't want to repeat the words before, that this simple innocent fracture in 3 months can end up with this picture. It looks very innocent, but remember that the soft tissue injury is really underestimated, especially in closed fracture, which is a real problem. And we can have the problems not only with conservative treatment, but also with the operative treatment. You can have Charcot joint also after operative treatment. Vascularity of the limb is usually preserved and the peripheral pulses may be bounding. And this is a real problem. We've been listening to the the important role of the vascular surgeon in treatment of Charcot joint. This was not our experience at all. Most of these patients have no vascular problem. Most of them, even the complicated cases. And in the beginning, 20 something years ago, we will usually have a vascular workout for each patient. But with developing experience, we don't think that this is needed. And this, the need for a vascular surgeon is not evidence-based. It's just a hypothesis that those people have vascular problems. What about the risk of amputation? You know, the risk of amputation in diabetic people is high, perhaps 10-fold more than normal. Limb salvage in this population is especially important. Given that 5 years mortality rate in the diabetic patients after lower extremity amputation is 39% to 68%. So amputation in Charcot foot or diabetic foot is not life-saving. You are harming the death of the patient. This paper is in 2005. That means 15 years ago, okay? This paper, 5 years ago. What about the incidence of mortality after amputation? In major amputation, 29% to 69%. In minor amputation, 52% to 80% for patients with major amputation. So do you think there is improvement? No, it's getting worse. Look to this paper, 2020. This is the most recent one. Look to the mortality rates after amputations among patients with diabetes. At 1 and 4 years, the major amputation, 33% to 65%. Minor amputation, 18% to 45%. There is no improvement whatsoever. This is hypothetical improvement. But if you look to the papers, it's even you have worse numbers. Perhaps the very high mortality rate is not just for amputation because the patient has other problems like coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular disease, but numbers won't lie. I'm not going to speak about the conservative treatment or different types of treatment. Just I chose this. A complete workup and optimization is important to achieve a successful outcome and satisfy the risk of complication. And these statements are really problematic. You can put this statement, this conclusion in each paper on earth. So just, I want the people to stop using the general terms. They can put them in average, it's not a conclusion. Now to the surgical treatment. We have to treat the patient, you have to treat the complications, you have to treat the deformity, you have to treat the instability, the infection, and recurrent ulceration, all of them together in the same patient. And I will show you some examples of what we do, what we usually do for the last 30 years. And we do tibial or tibiocalcaneal fusion. This is tibiocalcaneal fusion, tibiotalar fusion. Again, and I will give you some examples. This is Charcot arthropathy in child. In a child, she's 11 years old, child. And we had juvenile diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes. Sometimes we had the fasting blood sugar 500, sometimes more in these patients. It's really uncontrolled diabetes. And we decided to treat the patient with which she had bilateral dislocation and Charcot joint. We did the bloodless technique. We put the fixator and wire, just wires, and we corrected the deformity without any incision, and we did compression, distraction, compression. Look to the compression, distraction, compression. And you had complete union. And this is the left side. This is not complete union. The family was happy more with this arthrofibrosis because there are some movements. Look to the before and during treatment. And this is the right side, and this is the left side on both sides. This is the bloodless technique. You can use it in children. If you have Charcot arthropathy in children, you can correct the deformity and you can have stability. Again, we have a bone gap and we have chronic osteomyelitis, and the patient had a scan just to put the limit for the amputation. We do debridement. We used before to have a plastic surgeon to do the debridement for us, but we stopped that. And I will show you some example why we stopped this. Because we do other tactics for treatment. It's not just debridement, we do more. So we removed the soft tissues and bone, and we did compression, distraction, compression. And you see the skin and the union. Debridement and compression again with this infection. And in this case, it's not solid union, but you have a stable joint. Again, failure of internal fixation and controlled foot, and you see the picture after union. Bone transport, if you have a big bone gap and ulcers, multiple ulcers, uncontrolled diabetes, you can have lengthening and correction of the problem. With bone transport, we have complications. You have to know this. Pin-trike infection in all the cases. And I will tell you how we modified everything according to these situations. Most of the patients, they don't comply with the diabetic control. So if you have a patient, as I've told you, with uncontrolled diabetes for 25 years, don't expect him to have controlled diabetes after the operation. Why on earth is he going to change his behavior? I don't think he will. So we are expecting very high rate of pin-trike infection. And I will show you how we manage it, how we changed everything according to this situation. Sometimes you had a fracture of the tibia, which united completely. Malalignment, and I will show you example of the complication. And this is 75 years old female, as you see here. With the infection. And again, debridement, the compression, distraction, compression. And we developed this technique, and I will show you at the end. The way we do it now, because there are different stages in the management of these cases. Now, if you have a small fragment, we put multiple wires during removal of the fixators, and we put a frame on and we let the patient walk. Then we remove the wires after 1 month. You see complete union and the closure of the skin. Again, another patient with rheumatoid arthritis also, and failure of internal fixation and deformity and compression, distraction, compression. Now this is a Charcot foot which was scheduled for amputation. Look to the patient, infection, chronic osteomyelitis. In spina bifida, this is a patient with a spina bifida. We did transverse bone transport. What we do is to make a rectangle. This is 15 by 2 centimeters rectangle. We do multiple drill holes in the proximal tibia. It's far away from the lesion. This is proximal tibial transport. We did multiple drill holes, see here. Then we do an osteotomy of this and we leave it as such. Then we put half pins in this piece of bone. And we do transverse bone transport. And this is an example of the experimental study of the transverse bone transport. the transverse ponton sport. We wait for 1 week, then we push this fragment medially 1 millimeter per day. This will create new vasculature in this area and increases the blood supply of the limb, of the whole limb. You see, after 1 week, and this is just debrided by myself, because the orthopedic surgeon, the plastic surgeon refused to show up in this case because they think this is will not work out. So we did transverse bone transport from this small segment. This is after 1 week, after 1 month with the transport, after 2 months, look to the volar, the dorsal aspect and the sole of the foot. And this is the segment. You see the segment? We pushed the segment medially. We displaced the segment to increase the blood supply. And this is after 3 months. And this is indirect treatment of foot ulcers and Charcot foot. You see with the follow-up, and this is the segment of bone. We, after we pushed it medially, we return it back. This movement of this traction, transverse traction and back, this is increases, the, this increased the blood supply to the limb that you see here. This is before and after 2 years. Indirect treatment. Again, with the 60 years old diabetic overweight female, I will show you how we do it now, just how we change the frame and everything according to the patients. I know that we have to advise the patients and you have to make a teamwork and we have to teach them to come early and to control diabetes. But if they don't, are we going to punish them or something? So this patient, we had infected foot ulcers. There is a history of ray amputation in the same patient, and she's in a wheelchair. And of course, she was a real candidate for amputation. See the dislocated foot for just 2 years now. See, here she's, and cyanosed foot. She's in a wheelchair for more than 1 year now. And she did MRI, I didn't ask for, showing that the subtalar intertarsal joints also are affected. It's not just the ankle, so it's the whole foot is affected. Okay. And you, if you want to imagine the deformity, this is the tibia, the axis of the tibia, and this is the axis of the foot. So the foot has to move all this way around. She has the foot has to move about 120 degrees to get in position. So you have long standing ankle dislocation, deformity, wheelchair, resistant infected ulcer, functional level activity very low. So this she had all the prerequisites for amputation. So how to deal with all these problems, how to correct the deformity, how to do with the shortening, do you do corticotomy, ankle arthritis and instability, infected ulcer, do you need a plastic surgeon? If you want to correct the deformity, you have a problem. It's a severe deformity. You have to move the foot about 120 degrees. So we decided to do acute and gradual, both of them. And we decided not to do corticotomy. Why? Because the patient has, she has severe edema. And if you put a frame with a severe edema and the edema will disappear, it's going to be unstable. So I'll show you what to do. Now the way we do it this way, because we have high rate of pin track infection, marked swelling and edema, we used more levels of fixation. We used almost more than double the necessary level of fixations. We used different sizes of rings. So a size for the ankle and a size for the, so we use three sizes for the rings. We use more pins and wires. We do early removal of the infected wires in the outpatient clinic. So if you have infection of the wires, we remove it. We don't wait. Otherwise, we are going to have sequestrum. multiple intramedullary wires. I will show you an example. So this is after the operation. We corrected the deformity partially because for fear of the pressure on the vessels, and this is debridement. We did the debridement itself, and this is the frame. Look to the frame. We have three levels, three rings, and each level we have 3 points of fixation. Usually we need less than half of this. Even here we have four wires, here we have three wires. So if you have any severe penetrating infection, you remove the wires. And we use hydroxyapatite coated half pins. All this because of the recurrent penetrating infection. After this, we do the deduction, the primary wound closure, as you see here. We put multiple wires. The multiple wire technique, you put four or five wires, because you have very small segment, distal segment. And sometimes you cannot control this distal segment. You cannot align the ankle as you want. So we put the wires, and we know exactly that we still have about 60 degrees or 50 degrees equinus deformity, which you are going to correct gradually. You see the picture? This is after the operation. We still have about 50 degrees equinus deformity. We put the hinges and the distraction from behind. So with gradual distraction, we corrected the deformity. This is the approach. We removed parts of the fibula, transfibular approach to the ankle. As you see here, gradual correction of the deformity. Then we removed the frame. Again, we usually remove the frame earlier than expected. We remove the frame after 4.5 months. And during removal of the frame under general anesthesia, we put multiple wires again, retrograde. Why you put multiple wires? To stimulate again the bone formation in this small area of bone. Then we put the patient in a cast. And this is the way to put the cast. We leave this, the central part empty for the distal part of the wires. So we allow the patient to do full weight bearing with this cast. And at the same time, we lift this part just to withdraw it after 1 or 1.5 months. So this is the way to put the patient in a below knee cast and let the patient walk. This is how the patient walks with the cast. Then we exchange the cast after 1.5 months. This is after removal for the first cast. Why you put a cast? Because we don't want to leave the patient in the fixator for a long time, because we have been experienced with multiple recurrent pentrac infection, because usually the patients, they have uncontrolled diabetes and they will not improve after the operation, whatever you tell them. Patient, as I've told you, with uncontrolled diabetes for 30 years will not change his life or his lifestyle because you advised him. He will just pretend that he's going to change it, but this will not happen. So again, we remove the cast and we leave the tip of the wires. And we put another cast. And this is how the patient walks afterwards. And this is after removal of the second cast with the follow-up. You see the edema disappeared. And you see the picture. This is before, and this is after 1 year. Remember. In conclusion, the application of the law of tension stress and bone transport can be a good alternative for amputation in difficult cases. It's not the matter of external fixator at all. We use other principles, the bloodless technique, debridement, compression, distraction, longitudinal bone transport, transverse bone transport. Unfortunately, I've seen the people using the fixator in Charcot joints, but they use it as a buttress plate. They use it just as a caste. They didn't use any of these principles. My conclusion is not that teamwork. My conclusion is not early diagnosis. My conclusion is think differently. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Gamal, for this very interesting talk. Mr. Rami Sharif is with us as a moderator for the discussion between Professor Gamal and all our colleagues and our eminent stars in UK. Dr. Rami?
Thank you very much for the brilliant talks and for the brilliant speakers. It was an amazing day from all of you. I have received a few questions. The first one about the operative workup when you see a patient with diabetic foot. What is your, in your opinion, what is the perfect workup for such a patient? Shall I start by Mr. Wee and Mr. Anja? Mr. Wee first.
Hi. If you're talking about elective surgery, and I'm looking at a Charcot foot and they're coming into land for reconstruction, they would have had 6 weeks where there'd be no x-ray changes, their temperature difference is less than 2 degrees. They would have had a vascular workup already. Although the vascular pulses, although the pulses may well be present, they may indeed be monophasic. There's quite a stiff vessels there, so I need to be very careful when I'm correcting any big deformities in the foot. So I want to know about that. They will have their plaster removed at about 2 weeks and descaling of the foot. And once their skin is acceptable, then they would have their surgery. They would need to have an HbA1c of under 69 millimoles per mole of Hb. I think that's one of the requirements of our anesthetic department. They won't operate on anyone with bad diabetic control because the because we have a duty of care to improve that before we offer them elective surgery. And then the usual cardiac renal workup, and they have surgery, they come in for their operation. It's done under a mixture of regional and general anesthetic, and they stay in for maybe 2 or 3 days.
Thank you, Mr. Wee. Mr. Anjum?
Hi. Yeah, I mean, my approach is similar. They need workup, they need admission. Sometimes I admit them a few days prior to surgery to achieve the best optimization for their skin. It's easy to get the vascular opinion, everything when the patient is inside, but it's difficult to keep the patient in the hospital. So it's a balance of when you want to bring the patient, but at the same time, for any major reconstruction, you need to get them in the hospital, get the foot skin condition optimized, blood sugar has to be optimized. I find very difficult to achieve the anesthetic recommendation of achieving less than 69 of HbA1c. It's always difficult to get that, but our diabetic colleague, they are very helpful. They manage the patient perioperatively. And so it's very important to get good skin condition, medical optimization. Vascular input is important because you are correcting the deformity. So you need to know where the vessels are. And then again, MDT is the key to achieve best result at the end of the day. So that's how I prepare my patient.
Thank you, Mr. Anjum. Prof. Hosny?
No, this is not for me, this question.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Hosny. I have received a question from Prof. Koroni about the genetic factors in our Egyptian society. Have you seen, Prof. Hosny, have you seen any genetic factors in your patients?
I don't see them, but you know that in my facility, I receive the patients who are candidates for amputation. I don't receive the ordinary patients or something like this. So again, you can ask the guest speakers about these questions more.
Mr. Wee, have you ever needed to work up as a to genetically work up any patient with diabetic foot?
No, I don't look for their genes. No, we. I think that's a very interesting question, and it may to some degree answer why there's a sudden doubling of diabetes in Middle East and North Africa, or certain cultures that may genetically not be able to metabolically process so much sugar. But hey, I'm way out of my depth here. I just break the bones and reset them.
Keep it simple.
Yeah, I leave that to the PhDs.
Oh yeah. So we have talked about the elective diabetic foot surgery in case of emergency when we see a septic foot, and some of my colleague may say, no, it is not a septic foot, it is acute Charcot. What is your tips and tricks for a surgeon to differentiate between both of the cases and pick up the one which needs surgery? Mr. Wee.
Often a septic foot, there will be a point of entry and inoculation. It's very rare to have a septic arthritis. It's very rare to have cold sepsis. There will be penetrating, there's often a history of penetrating trauma or mild trauma or a long-standing ulcer. With a Charcot foot, the patient will give a history of feeling a mild click, a very small click with minimal exertion of activity, present to the GP with a sprain, and they come with loss of definition of their foot shape. They will have a red hot, swollen, warm foot, and by the time they present to you in clinic, you will see X-ray changes. It's very rare we pick up acute Charcots unless it's a diabetic with a simple innocuous ankle fracture that goes on to collapse, like my colleagues have demonstrated with some of their slides.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Anjum, I'm sorry.
So just repeat the question again.
In case of emergency department, if I receive a referral from the ED about diabetic foot, what is your tips and tricks to differentiate between diabetic foot as a sepsis or acute Charcot, and I need to wait for it?
Most of the time, I mean, you have to be suspicious that any foot has got, there is a chance that it may be an infected foot. As Alex was showing in the initial slides, the redness, erythema, point of entry, if there is a point of entry which is visible. So it's a very detailed examination of the foot that can help you in assessing whether it's an infected foot or it's a Charcot, acute Charcot. Generally, acute Charcot starts improving the swelling and things once you elevate it, but there will be associated sign of infection, like, although the immunity is not great, but still there will be sign of infection, systemic infection visible. And I think in such cases where there is a confusion is whether it's an infected foot or a Charcot foot, I think the MRI scan is very helpful. So that I tend to get a scan as soon as possible if I've got confusion, and that helps in basically making the decision whether which way I'm going to treat the patient. And close observation, again, medical optimization and everything is important, but that's how this is the detailed examination and observation over maybe 24 to 48 hours, that makes the difference, and the early use of MRI scan.
Okay, the next question for Prof. Hosny. I know and I believe you receive the most complex foot cases for your external fixator, But with a Charcot foot and surgical technique with a circular external fixation, what is your treatment algorithm for patients with mild deformity and severe deformity? How do you pick up your patients for a circular frame?
I don't pick the patients, they come to me. So it's not my choice. They, you know, it's usually they come to me because they were scheduled for amputation or something like this. So I don't have minor cases or mild deformity cases or something like this. Most of the cases, you've seen the examples of the cases that I've seen you. The circle fixator is nothing. The principles and the ideas, you know, because I've seen many people using the circle fixator just as a butter plate. Not just in Egypt, in everywhere. They use it just like they put a cast or something and they say, you know, we put Ilizarov or we put TSF or we put Hexapodal or something and it ended up with failure. Because they don't follow the principles. You know, I didn't talk about the fixator at all because of the, I think about the problems. Are you going to use a bloodless technique, compression, distraction, compression, especially in children with Charcot foot and ankle? Are you going to use it with a transverse bone transport for the foot ulcers? Are you going to use it for a longitudinal bone transport? Are you going to use just minimal debride, the compression, distraction, and so on? And you have, I've shown you a case of infection, which is extended infection, but we just resected the piece because we think compression, distraction, compression raises the blood supply, which will fight the infection. Remove only the sequestrated bone, not the infected bone, because the infected bone is a living bone. So it's not the matter of the circular fixator, it's the matter of the principles you are using with HVS. The circular fixator is just a tool, and I think you can use the same principles with other fixators if you want to.
Brilliant, thank you very much. So second question is for Prof. Hosny. With these complex cases about decision-making, when do you say that this patient or this deformity is not for conserved, it is not for salvage, it is for amputation?
The only patient which I didn't tell the patient, but I thought about amputation was really, patient was, she was 40, 45, 6 years old. And I think the blood sugar is something like 400 or more all the time, no way. And we removed the fixator only. And I've shown you the picture. She had the pathological fracture of the tibia. There was, I think, the stress fracture in all the way. And she had the pathological fracture of the tibia. And we put her in a cast, and I decided to tell her to go to, she's a candidate for amputation. But she came to me after 2 months with complete union of the fracture. And again, there was recurrence of infection. Then infection disappeared. Why? Because she had a fracture, and the fracture is like a corticotomy. With the union, the blood supply increased with the limb, and the infection disappeared. And this was the only patient which I thought this was a real candidate for the amputation. Apart from this, usually we don't tell the patients. We construct almost all the cases which receive. We think amputation, it's not what I think. I've shown you in the evidence-based literature, if you do an amputation for a diabetic patient, you are hastening the death of the patient. And I don't know why on earth some surgeons, they perhaps not orthopedic surgeons, vascular surgeon, they just tell the patient that amputation in these cases is life-saving. It's not life-saving. It's going to hasten your death. It's going to make you closer to death if you do an amputation. The numbers are huge, up to 68% or something like this. The patients will die from 1 to 4 years after amputation in such cases. That's why we reserve the amputation, and we don't think that amputation is necessary except if you have a vascular problem, which we didn't see. The people exaggerate about the vascular problems. And now, and we were exaggerating before, but now we don't think so. So just I wanna tell the other people that think on the other way. Many situation, you know, in the recent era, you know, as they, we always listen to evidence-based medicine, evidence-based medicine, evidence-based medicine. But if you look to the roots, there is no evidence at all. It's just hypothetical ideas, hypothetical ideas. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Prof. Hosny. So you have mentioned multiple techniques and multiple, basics of external fixation. In Charcot foot, we often see poor bone stock and soft tissue compromised. Have you ever needed to do internal fixation in combination with your frame or use any bone graft or substitute for your cases?
And you know, if you call the multiple KYRs internal fixation, you can say this is an internal fixation. But now in most of the cases, which we have a small tibial segment, you know, or arthrodesis of the ankle, we use the multiple wires techniques just because we want to remove the fixator early, because of the high rate of pentrike infection. And we put the wires and we put this cast, as I've shown you, and we let the patient walk, then we remove the wires after 1.5 months. And this is an important point. Apart from this, we don't use internal fixation. Most of the cases are really infected. They have infected ulcers sometimes for years. And we don't think that there is a place for internal fixation. Perhaps for the people doing it, it's true. But for me, if I have these patients and I have to close the wound primarily, you know, we close the wound primarily after a section of this segment. If you want to put internal fixation, there is high risk of infection, especially most that I've told you, most of the neglected cases, they have uncontrolled diabetes and they will not improve after the operation. They will not change after 15 years or 20 years from uncontrolled diabetes to controlled diabetes just because you told them. So I think it's pretty dangerous if you want to put internal fixation in these cases that I've shown you, not simple cases.
Thank you very much. There is a question from Mr. Wei to Prof. Hosny about how you prepare the joint surfaces with your bloodless technique in children.
In children, we don't do any incision. We don't. We put the frame, then after the operation, we correct the deformity 1 millimeter per day. And after we correct the deformity, we do three cycles of compression. And after we do compression, we wait for a couple of weeks, then we do distraction and wait for a couple of weeks, then compression, then distraction, 1 millimeter per day. Compression, distraction, compression in children, you know, we have many fragments inside. The force of low of tension stress will increase the blood supply and will allow for healing of the tissues. But there are no incisions. Those children, you know, it's terrible. You have child with fasting blood sugar more than 600 or something sometimes.
So your aim is to achieve a stable fibrous ankylosis.
In you know, in this
case,
one is fibrous and the one is bony. The ankle, the one ankle is a fibrous ankylosis and yep, the other is bony ankylosis. For me, fibrous ankylosis is not 100% success, but it's very valuable.
No, it's a functional, successful operation. I agree. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I don't have any further questions for the panelists.
Thank you, Mr. Rami, for this fantastic moderation. Finally, at the end of this very fruitful scientific night, I would like to thank Mr. Wee, Mr. Anjam, Mr. Maghrabi, Professor Hosny, and my dear friend, Dr. Rami Sharif. Thank you so much, our eminent guest speakers tonight. It was a very, very fruitful scientific night. Thank you so much.
Thank you.